Good morning, interweb. Let's world build. Today, let's embark on a bit of terrestrial planet moon building. For the purposes of this build, I'm going to classify moons by size and composition. Size. All natural satellites can either be major moons or minor moons. Minor moons are small satellites that lack the necessary gravity to force them into a spherical shape. These potato-shaped bodies, like the moons of Mars, will be no greater than about 200 to 300 kilometers in size. Major moons, on the other hand, like our moon, are gravitationally rounded, and as such, they must have radii larger than 200 to 300 kilometers. Composition. Moons can be either predominantly rocky, again like our moon, or predominantly icy, like Mimas. A grid like this, although simplistic, is a very useful tool when it comes to moon building. So here's a system comprised solely of terrestrial planets. Three inner worlds, one in the habitable zone, and one outer planet. Before we plot the location of any moons, it's worth going over some general guidelines. 1. Amount. For the most part, terrestrial planets will have very few satellites, if any. They may occasionally capture a few asteroid minor moons, but they are unlikely to have any major moons. 2. Habitability. Terrestrial planets intended to be habitable must have at least one major moon. Major moons are pretty much a prerequisite for habitability. They help moderate a planet's climate by stabilizing its axial tilt. Without a moon, Earth would look less like this and more like this. 3. Distance. Close-in planets will have less moons than distant planets. Compare moonless Mercury with Pluto's veritable orgy of moons. And 4. Composition. Inner system moons will be predominantly rocky, and outer system moons will be predominantly icy. So with all this in mind, I'd elect to give this guy no moons, this guy one captured asteroid minor moon, my habitable world must have a rocky major moon, which probably formed as a result of a collision similar to that which formed our moon, and I'll give this distant guy, four icy minor moons. Just cause I can. Alrighty then, moon building, engage! As the habitable world will likely be the most important locale in the system, let's begin by constructing its moon. First up, let's figure out what it's made of. We know it needs to be predominantly rocky, so let's say it's comprised of 90% silicate rock, 10% iron, and 1% water ice. Simply multiply the density of each material by the percentage you choose to get the overall density of your moon. In this case, we're looking at a density of about 3.72 grams per centimeter cubed, aka 0.68 times the density of Earth. Next, we can use this equation to find our moon's mass and radius. M, the mass of our moon in Earth masses, is equal to its radius in Earth radii cubed, multiplied by its density in Earth densities, which we already have. Because we're building a major moon, we want to select a radius greater than 200 to 300 kilometers, aka 0.03 to about 0.05 Earth radii. Let's say our moon would be just under a third the size of Earth, which gives us a mass of 0.018 Earth masses. This makes it slightly more massive than Earth's moon, which is perfect. In order to ensure our moon will stabilize our habitable world, we need to design it in such a way as to be physically comparable to Earth's moon. As a quick aside, a satellite's mass must always be less than or equal to the mass of the planet it orbits. However, the closer the two objects are in mass, the more the system begins to resemble a double planet system, a la Pluto and Charon. A useful point for those wishing to construct double habitable planets. Now, let's plug our mass and radius into this equation to get our moon's surface gravity relative to Earth's. In this case, its surface gravity is 0.2, about 23% higher than that of Earth's moon. So that's the essential physical parameters taken care of. Let's put the moon into orbit. To do this, we're going to need to know the physical characteristics of our star and our planet. I've covered the construction of stars and planets in previous videos, so click the links on screen or in the doobly-doo if you need a bit of a refresher. TLDR, my star here is identical to our sun, and the planet is a slightly larger version of Earth. Anyways, planets, like all astronomical objects, are encased in a sort of gravitational bubble we call a hilsphere. Any object inside a planet's hilsphere will be gravitationally bound to that planet. So by definition, satellites must be placed inside this bubble, the outer limit of which is given by the equation A, the semi-major axis of the planet's orbit in AU, times the cube root of the mass of the planet in Earth masses, divided by the mass of the star in solar masses, multiplied by 235. Plugging the relevant numbers in gets me a value of roughly 269. That is, this planet's hilsphere extends out roughly 269 Earth radii from the center of the planet. Those who watched my rings video will know that a moon cannot orbit arbitrarily close to a planet, so the inner limit here is given by the Roche limit, 2.44 times the radius of our planet in Earth radii, times the density of the planet divided by the density of the moon, to the third power. Again, whack the relevant numbers in, and out pops 2.65. So the inner limit lies 2.65 Earth radii from the centre of our planet. Bit of bonus info here is that moons also have Hill spheres and Roche limits, meaning it's theoretically possible to construct moons of moons. Regardless, this right here is moon territory. In general, terrestrial planet moons will be what's known as regular satellites. That is, they orbit relatively close to the planet on prograde, uninclined, nearly circular orbits. Close to the planet generally means within half of the maximum value here. So I'll put my moon into orbit about 80 Earth radii out. I'll give it a prograde orbit, a very low inclination, say 2 degrees, and a very low eccentricity, about 0.01. Oh, and for those wishing to construct two separate major moons, ensure that they never come within 10 planetary radii of each other. Now, our moon's orbital period, which will play an important role in future calendar building, will be given by 0.0558 times the square root of the radius of the moon's orbit in Earth radii cubed, divided by the sum of the masses of the planet and the moon in Earth masses. After another bout of intense number vomit, we get an orbital period of 34.15 Earth days. So lunar months on this world will be roughly 34 Earth days long. And that right there is how one goes about constructing moons for habitable Earth-like planets. Now, on to the other terrestrial planets. Uninhabitable terrestrial planets require a very different moon-building technique. Why? Because... 1. Terrestrial planets shouldn't really be given any major moons. Earth is anomalous in this regard. Instead, we have to deal with minor moons. Minor moons aren't spheres, so there's less we can slash need to say about them. And 2. The stabilization effect of minor moons is minimal, so we can be more liberal when choosing their orbits. Let's start with this guy. It's rocky, so by definition its density should be in the ballpark of 3 grams per centimeter cubed. The higher the value here, the more iron content the minor moon will have, useful for those wishing to construct potential mining locations. I'll go with a density of 4 grams per centimeter cubed, aka about 3 quarters the density of Earth. The moon is non-spherical, so its shape can be whatever we want it to be, but for ease of construction, I'd advocate modelling minor moons as ellipsoids. Which means we're going to need to specify 3 axes, A, B, and C. Let's say this guy is very roughly 80 kilometers by 50 kilometers by 30 kilometers, like this. Cause you know, who doesn't like Fibonacci inspired minor moons? FYI, ellipsoids come in 3 distinct flavors: triaxial ellipsoids, where A is greater than B, which in turn is greater than C; oblate spheroids, where A and B are equal and greater than C; and prolate spheroids, where A and B are equal but less than C. Choose at will. With density, size, and shape done, let's talk mass. The mass of an ellipsoid is given by rho, the density, times 4 over 3 pi times the 3 axes, A, B, and C. To make sure the units work out, we have to multiply each of our inputs by 1000. In this case, my moon ends up with a mass of about 2 times 10 to the power of 18 kilograms. Which seems like a lot, but really it's just 0.00000033 Earth masses. Now, we could try and set surface gravity, but given the irregularity of minor moons, even I think that would be overkill. I mean, determining their mass is already sort of overkill, surface gravity would be a total fatality. Simply knowing a minor moon's composition, size, and shape is more than enough, really. That said, let's put this guy into orbit. Same method applies as before: find the Hill sphere, like so, and the Roche limit, like so, and place your moon within this zone. Because the minor moons of terrestrial planets will likely be captured asteroids, they can pretty much orbit anywhere in the zone, no restrictions. So I'll place this guy at about 30 Earth radii out, giving him an orbital period of just over 11 Earth days. Minor moon, done. Same stick with our distant terrestrial planet. I selected 4 densities that indicated an icy composition, i.e. in and around 1 to 2 grams per centimeter cubed. The higher density values here indicate a mixture of rock and ice, dirty snowballs if you will. I made 3 of them oblate spheroids and 1 a triaxial ellipsoid, and placed each of them in the moon zone whilst ensuring that no 2 moons came within 10 planetary radii of each other. And there you have it, 1 terrestrial planetary system all decked out in moons. Next time we'll look at gas giant moon systems and the possibility of habitable moons. Stay tuned. Good morning, interweb. So I am just after finishing editing and I'm on a walk out in the nature with the captain.
Hi.
So whilst I was editing, I spotted 2 mistakes and it was too late to fix them. They are at 217 and 552, the details of which are going to be in the doobly-doo. TLDR,
what I write on screen is correct, but what I say isn't. This is totally my fault, obviously. I tried to record the audio at like 3 in the morning and that was a terrible idea. So those two mistakes snuck in. Hopefully they are the only two mistakes. If you guys happen to find more, let me know and I will also put them in the correction section. Oh, it's a dog. They're so cute. Admittedly, this has been a seriously dense video, so if there's anything you didn't understand or you need help with, let me know in comments and I'll sort you out. If there's one thing I like doing, it's talking about world building with you guys. So click the links on screen or in the description for more Artifexing content. Like, and if you think I earned it, hit the subscribe button. Thank you all so much for watching. Edgar out.